Right. I'm supposed to speak in English for this class. I'll speak slowly, and if there's any difficult words or anything that you would like me to explain more, please do go to slido.com 405. And as you can see, there's already somebody there and asking that what is my topic today. Just to explain, usually I start with a presentation, and in this case, I start with this slide that I presented with the deputy ministers and the other participation officers in the executive yuan in the administration a few days ago. And so I will talk a little bit about open government and how we are effecting open government in the administration. But my usual habit, if you will, is to go back to Slido whenever there's like 9 or 10 questions. When there's like 9 or 10 questions, I will stop whatever I'm presenting and I'll go back to Slido. And so in a sense that what I will be talking about, the topic that I'll be talking about, is collectively determined by you. You don't have to ask questions related to open government, although you are welcome to. You can ask, well, anything. And so if you see somebody asking a question that you would also like to ask, such as this one, which has 2 likes, you can simply press like, and then you will float to the top, and I will answer based on the number of likes that the question has. Is that okay with you? Okay, cool. Let's get started. And so this is my second time in this kind of class. The first time was in Taipei, and there were people who struggled to ask questions in English. So if you really have to, you can also ask your question in Chinese, and I will translate it back to English as to fit the theme of this talk today. So without further ado, let's get started. So as many of you probably already know, open government is my primary work as the digital minister. So what do we mean by open government, and what does it entail in actual practice? So according to OECD and many other international bodies, open government is the idea that we can make the government more transparent to everybody involved. And by transparent, we mean that whenever we're making decisions, we try to reveal as much as possible the evidence, the facts, the data that we use, the rationale that we use for making policies. And but why are we doing this? This is because if the government delays until the latest possible moment, that is to say when effecting the policy, it has to actually assume that everybody who has an idea, who has an input, who has something to contribute to this policy, has already voiced their concerns. Otherwise, if you just, you know, make decisions by ourselves and then announce it without telling everybody that we are going to do this policy development, then people who disagree or people who simply have something to contribute but was not aware that they could contribute would actually let you know either on the street or on the internet. So this is somewhat reactive. The transparency means we need to let people know not just what we're doing, but what we are going to do and why we're going to do this, so that people who has something to contribute can actually contribute. And the second part, participation, means that we need to have a way to receive ideas, inputs, reflections from the civil society, from the private sector, that is more effective than before. Before, we had public hearings, we had environmental evaluations, we had a lot of different processes to get people's sound ideas. But the thing is that it does not scale. What we mean in scale in computer science is that many people can do it at once. For example, there is only one microphone here. So if I am to ask you what kind of questions you have, what kind of suggestions you have on my topic today, if I pass the microphone around, then by the end of the、passing the microphone around and everybody asked me what they want to hear and so on, the time would already have been passed. Like, it would take like 1 hour or 2 hours for everybody here to speak、one after another using a microphone. So which is why a participation framework is important. For example, today, Slido is our participation framework.It enables me to continue speaking and you without interrupting me to nevertheless determine what you would like me to talk about. So this is what we mean by participation. Now,、this actually has many different、Chinese translations. In English, it's called accountability, but in Chinese, it's variously translated as 客责、当责、问责 or whatever, right? It's a、kind of nebulous term, and it's not very much used in everyday policymaking、language here in Taiwan at the moment. In English, accountability is linked to its root, account. To give an account, like an accountant, accounting, means that you keep a record of what you have done, and when you have done that, and why have you done it. So whereas transparency means announcing beforehand what you are going to do, accountability means that keeping a record of what you have already done and who have done what. So it's a、history keeping. And the reason why accountability is important is becauseFor many、different projects that the government is doing, it's like many different puzzle pieces that when taken together affects a useful policy or a strategy. But because it's very complicated, it may take many actions from the administration, it may take、from the regional government, it may take actions from the civil society, from the social sector, and from the private sector.So accountability is the way that we say we keep a record of whatever everybody's contribution to this larger picture so that people can,、they won't take credit for what they have not done. And on the other hand, they can ask us to explain why have we done this. So this accountability also means in addition to keeping an account, also answering based on the account of the inquiries that people ask us.And、OECD、initially、defines open government as just these three,、transparency, participation, and accountability. And across the world, ever since、ex-President、Obama announced the Open Government Initiative back in 2011,、there's many, many countries in the world who have taken open government and these three principles as their、fundamental value to regain the trust.That the citizens,、which is even lower and lower, even in advanced democratic countries. So it is, was built as a way back in 2012 or 2013 as a way for government to regain trust people. And the idea is that people would not trust the government without the government trusting the people. So the government has to first trust the people to see what the government is doing without misjudging it.To participate without degenerating into populism, to hold the government accountable without going into lynching or witch hunting or other things like that. So it is an enormous trust, and many governments did not used to trust people like that, but they have found out if they distrust people, people distrust back. And this is not a healthy relationship. So it's like with a romantic relationship, somebody has to yield first, somebody has to trust more.Right, so it is the government's duty、to trust a little bit more of the people and maybe the people will trust back. And after a few years of practicing open government of the worldwide、countries, they found out even for the government who has done open government really well, it creates a new class. It creates a new class that is usually young, usually well-educated, maybe living near the capital,They did not care about politics, but because of open government, they now have agenda-setting power, meaning that they can tell the government what to think about, what to talk about. So it is a much more politically active class, which is great as far as democracy is concerned. But it also means that people who did not have a habit of using the internet for discourse, people who did not prefer writing, or numbers, people who prefer to talk face to face, people who prefer to touch things that they're, or drawing things that they're more interested in and so on, usually gets excluded when a country installs an open government framework. It privileges people who are good at typing, people who are good at numbers, people who are good at data, and they become a kind of new elite under open government relationships. So this is why when we are practicing open government in Taiwan, from the very beginning, from 2014 or so, we added the idea of inclusion into the core three open government idea. And inclusion means very simply that we use the technologies not to exclude people, meaning that to make people who did not participate even further from participation. Every single technology that we introduce must be inclusive, meaning that it allows people who did not have the means to participate to nevertheless find a way to participate. So for example, when in Taipei City, when the open government workers worked with Mayor Kohinger on a social housing distribution mechanism, they, by law, we have 10% of social housing that is distributed to disadvantaged people who could not afford housing. However, in Taipei City, they added 20% more, saying that it is allocated to people who can theoretically afford housing, but no landlords want to rent to them. And who are these people? These are single parents. These are people living with HIV, with immunodeficiency. These are people who were, you know, sleeping on the street. These are people who are affected by natural disasters. These are people who are aborigines, for example, or people who suffer from mental or physical handicap. And so when the mayor said, we want to let these people, disadvantaged people, to collectively determine what is fair to distribute those 20% of social housing, that we must do this by the open government principle that he promised during his campaign. The problem immediately becomes, do we use technology to do this? Do we use an internet platform to enable people to see the social housing's principles? Do we install a participation framework so people can use their phone to ask questions? Do we put an entire accountability record so people know going into a meeting what has transpired before in the previous meetings? Now, of course, if we just set up a website to do this, if we very simply say, okay, everybody can go to this join.gov.tw to participate, it will be a nightmare because these disadvantaged people, not many of them have the luxury to use their mobile phones to participate in policy development. And if we say, okay, we just listen to whatever the poll, the iVoting on the website, then it will basically privilege the few people among the disadvantaged people who can go to the website. So we don't do that. What we did was we, instead of asking people to come to technology, we bring technology to people. So it's not like we didn't use technology, we did use technology. But we use technology for sign language interpretation so that people who are you know, having hearing disabilities can nevertheless follow the discussion. We have real-time captions that types at what everybody says. For people who are paralyzed, we use live streaming to bring the discussion to them and to hold those kind of face-to-face deliberations in the location that is close to them. And before, we did not say, okay, anybody who can go to this website have input. No, you have to first show that you are one of those disadvantaged people. And we do this not by randomly calling people. We do this by having a rolling survey. The people who worked with the Taipei City government asked the associations who represent those disadvantaged people not as experts and go to the meeting. Instead, they were asked to produce a list of people that they know, the actual history, this family diagrams that their constituents have. And then the same survey, the same question is then sent sometime door to door to these disadvantaged people, asking who else do you know that the city government may have missed. And so by these kind of many waves of rolling survey, the Taipei City team were able to reach many disadvantaged people who did not think that they could have an input into the policy making, that they did not even know that there is going to be a social housing. And then by getting everybody on the same place and have the aborigines listen to the story of the autists listen to the story of paralyzed people and so on, they were able to form some consensus instead of, fighting each other to get more percentage. They were able to collaboratively design a system that would make it much better for them to live together. And so this is the kind of spirit that we want to encourage in the assistive technology, in the idea of inclusion. So if you don't have a mobile phone and you could not connect to Slido, please do feel free to raise your hand or not raise your hand and interrupt me at any time and nevertheless ask your question. It is not like by having the Slido system that we ignore people who could not get to it. So these are the four principles of open government that we're trying to further. Now going back to Slido. There's two questions. We'll take a few seconds. Right, so this is a great question. Terence asks, what is the difference between open government and e-government? And another person said, how do government use technology to enhance administration function and effect? So, as many of you know, the National Development Council has long ago started planning the idea of e-government or 电子化政府, in our national development plan. And at the moment, it is now the fifth installment of the e-government plan. By e-government, usually, as we heard the word 电子化, electronic, it means, very simply, take what is not electronic, paperwork, and replace it with something that's electronic, computers or, stylus. So these are electronic, while the old system based on paper were not electronic. There are, of course, very good reasons to use electronic devices. Archival is much easier. But on the other hand, paper actually has a very good user experience. This means that when I work with paper, I know exactly where it is. Although I could not do full text search, I can do a lot of annotation. I can do a lot of binding, sealing, all sorts of different actions that you can make on paper that if on a computer using keyboard and mouse, it actually takes longer to do the same thing. So a lot of e-government work is trying to work with the users and find a way to replace those paperwork with equivalent electronic work that actually makes it saves people's time instead of requiring people to spend even more time just to make it electronic. So this was our main challenge in the e-government plan. But the e-government plan, at least in its first four installments, did not emphasize the complete rework of the workflow. If you had an approval workflow back in paper-based days, even switching to an electronic approval system, exactly the same approval logic still applies. So even though everybody has an email now, people still use it very much like the old mail system. You don't see a lot of government people writing an email to everybody in their department, even though they can technically do that. So it means that the workflow itself was sometimes, and usually actually I would say, left the same, while just the device are upgraded to something that's more convenient, that could be searched, and so on. So in the current installment of e-government plan, 第五阶段电子化政府, we're calling it a digital government. And by digital government, we are doing a rethink of now that we have those digital tools, maybe we can change the workflow a little bit. The message flow in the old electronic system still flowed only within the same department or the same unit. It flows vertically. But it is actually now possible for information to flow horizontally. And If I'm not mistaken, many of you already do that. You just do it using systems outside the normal administration systems. People use the Line app. People use Facebook. They use Google apps. They use all kind of tools that were not designed for administration work, for government work. They were designed so that you can catch up with your friends or send photos with your families. But because they are horizontal and they are scalable, meaning that they can reach a lot of people very quickly compared to the electronic or not government system, many people did take to use Line, to use Google, to use even Facebook for their internal communication. And this, of course, has an advantage. It is very liberating, I'm sure. But it also has its disadvantage. In particular, the workflow that was built using those external tools, those external social media tools, they were not permanent. It means that it mostly depends on the idea of one or two key people running the system, whether it's a Google Doc, whether it's a Line group, or something like that. So if that somebody changes their job, it is actually very difficult to hand off to their successors using these ad hoc social media tools. Maybe the next person uses, Joker instead of Line. Maybe the next person uses a different set of communication tools, maybe Office 365 instead of Google Apps, and so on. So it actually creates a lot of headache in terms of information management in the government. So this is the state, and I'm not saying that it is good or bad, this is the state that we have today. So one of my work as a digital minister is to work with the administration to establish the same kind of information infrastructure, for example, the Line-like communication system, a collaborative document just like Google Docs or Google Spreadsheet, and so on, but built with systems with open and free tools inside the government. So this is what we have been prototyping, and recently it just passed the independent testing of our cybersecurity department, so that this system in our what we call PDIS, NATGOVTW, so that this system, what we call Sunstorm, it is actually what I use every day. And then you can see the same shared folders, the same real-time chats, and so on, that people can use. And it keeps like collaborative spreadsheets and everything, just like the Google Apps, and so on. So here is where we invite everybody who is a public servant in, so that we can collaborate using these tools to change not only the device that they use, but the workflow that they use. And it requires very little learning, because these free tools are modeled after, for example, Excel, for example, Word. So it is actually not difficult to start using. So we've just finished the cybersecurity audit that proves that it's safe. But nevertheless, we will start recording lessons and giving our training classes, so it gives an alternative to Google tools and to Line and so on for people who are interested in doing this kind of dynamic workflow in the public service. So on the question of how do we use technology to enhance administration function and effect, so I talk about turning paper into bits, into digital records. And for archival, for example, there's a lot of existing paper that we still need to make into a digital workflow. So one of the key technology that we're using as of this year, trying, is a machine learning. For example, I'll use a very concrete case. The administration, when they're working on records and sending it to the judicial branch, our administration branch of law, the Ministry of Justice, always prepares a lot of paperwork that they call it 卷宗检察官 that sends it to their counterparts in the judiciary. And these are very often just paper. There is no digital records. Even though they were digital inside the ministry, they were not digital when it's sent outside of the administration branch. But why is the reason? Because by law, there is a law that says you have to 封卷 to seal the paperwork and to send it out. So even if they need a digital record for many important criminal cases, they will send out the paper to the judiciary and then for them to start working on it and then loan it back and then start scanning so that they have a digital copy. They do need a digital copy, but because the law focuses on paperwork, they thought it's much more important to get a paper there first. So there's a lot of limitations here. So why are we, you know, working with this very inefficient system? One of the reasons is that the scanner used to take a lot of time. If you have a 200 page book, and if you have to, you know, flip it down and then scan it page by page, it will usually take around 10 to 20 seconds per page for people to scan it. So of course, if you do this, then it will delay the prosecution by 2 days or 3 days if it's an important case with a lot of paperwork. And of course, nobody can, you know, take responsibility for delaying this much, which is why they send it out and then take it back and gradually scan it. But this is silly because there are now machines that can very easily scan at, you know, 3 seconds a page, 1 second a page. That is very trivial. It's just like a lamp. The scanner is on top, and then you put a book or anything here, and then you just start flipping. And if you can flip as fast as you want, it just detects where each page is, and it's not even very expensive. It's just new technology that was productionized maybe a couple of years ago. But because it was relatively new, it was introduced a couple of years ago, it's not in our common procurement, it's not in Gong Tong Gou Mai. So, of course, when people think about how do we solve the scanning problem, they would not think about that. But it could have saved literally weeks of time for you know, everybody involved. And once you have this fast scanning technology, you can then work with machine learning to try to recognize the handwritten text or the printed text so that you can do full text searching. And once you can do full text searching within those cases, then it will increase the quality of the prosecution and the quality of lawyers working on it, because they will be able to focus on the part of evidence that actually matters. And actually, in the US and in the UK, they are now experimenting not just full text searching, but actually interactive questions. You can ask a machine learning system, a AI, what are the relevant precedents for this case, and they will search the entire history of their cases and return to you the part that is related to this particular case. And once they start doing this, the time that the lawyers, the time that the judges spend on the case can spend on the part that requires human creativity, that requires human judgment. They will not need to spend a lot of time just looking up the names, looking up the actual paragraphs and so on. These very repetitive work, no matter what kind of people do it, you will get the same result. And so these kind of redundant work, Ronggong in Mandarin, is of course best delegated to machines. But if we don't have a scanner, we don't even get to hear. Right, so the idea of digital tools in the government is just not just to solve one single problem in every case, which is of course still important, but to think of a new workflow that could save everybody's time involved. Another anonymous, I love the anonymous system because we get the best questions this way. If everybody has to use real name, we don't get these kind of interesting questions. An anonymous friend asked, do you like your job in the executive yuan? Does it match what I expected before entering the cabinet? Yes. So I'm actually not new to the administration. I've been working with the administration on digital government, on open government, since at least 2014. Back in 2014, I was working as an advisor to the National Development Council's Open Data Advisory Committee, and also as an independent expert to Minister, then ex-minister Jacqueline Tsai Yuling, and then, of course, the then deputy premier, Simon Zhang, Zhang Sanzhen. So I was kind of understudy, if you will, who worked with the administration at that time, because after the Sub-Saharan movement, after the Occupy, the cabinet at the end of 2014 actually starts saying, if you remember, crowdsourcing and open data and big data as their three main strategies. And these basically means the transparency and participation part of the open government plan. So although they were just installing half of the open government plan, it is still a step to the right direction, which is why I agreed to work with the cabinet back then. So, and I work also with the Ministry of Education for the new curriculum. So, now this cabinet, of course, takes a lot more importance in the open government plan, that they're willing to take accountability and inclusion also very seriously, and human rights very seriously. But I would say between the two independent prime ministers, that is to say Premier Zhang Tanzhen and Premier Lin Quan, they were both independent. They belong to no parties. I never belong to any party. And the idea during the transition, the 4 months of transition, many of my friends in the international community, they said they've never seen a peaceful transition in Taiwan like this. They remember Taiwan, especially if they are like 40 or 50 years old. They remember Taiwan as a place where you know, people in the parliament throw chairs at each other. Or they remember Taiwan as sometimes like very, I would say, charged or passionate discussions between the two parties and so on. So they were very surprised back in last year's election that the transition between the two cabinets was completely peaceful. And one of the reasons was that Simon Zhang asked each ministry to upload what he calls a checkpoint document. That is to say, what the ministry has done, why has they done that, what are the data that backs these decisions up into the public internet. So it is not just one party handing the power to another party. It is an independent premier asking his cabinet to provide an account that is part of accountability to the entire world, not just Taiwanese people, and for the new cabinet, including, of course, Premier Lin Quan, to download it from the public internet and to resume what they have done. And this, of course, benefits me because I didn't know that I would be part of the new cabinet, but I nevertheless have access to the same checkpoint document as everybody else here does. So I also can see which part of the national development plan, which part of the Shizheng Fangzhen of the, you know, the national direction actually keeps the same between the two cabinets, and what part actually got changed because of new values that was introduced by the new cabinet. And this was very helpful to me, but I'm sure also helpful to everybody else. So I know what to expect going into the new cabinet, and so far it's been exactly the same as I expected. Right, so the next question is also very good. What is the benefit for public servants to achieve open government? This is a great question, because if you ask from anybody else's angle, like for example, for young people who want to participate in discussion, of course open government gives them more things to talk about. If you are part of the small or medium enterprise who wants to know what kind of regulations is going to affect you, of course open government makes your job much easier. And if you're part of a civil society, an NGO or association, they want the government to think about the thing that you care about, of course open government helps you. But what's in it for career public servants? Why are the career public servants who are already very much overworked going to put more hours into open government? So although this is the theoretical slide that I usually show to our participation officers, But I usually just show them this single slide saying open government has the two reasons, an external reason that is for the people in the society, that everything that I have explained. But it also has an internal reason that is despite, you know, all the benefit that it has to civil society and to citizens and to private sector, for the public sector, it has one concrete reason that says career public servants. We were, well, and I think of myself as a career public servant now. So we, career public servants, compared to elected officials, to 政务官, in Taiwan's system, it has the, I usually joke that we have the worst part of the UK system where the public servants are anonymous, right? The UK system says the Korean public servants are anonymous, but they're professional. They were able to tell elected officials that this is a bad idea and you should not install it and so on. So they keep the elected officials in check, but they remain anonymous. Whereas in other European systems, Korean public servants are they can just defend the policy that they make, but they don't have they have to listen to the elected officials on the overall direction. But Taiwan's like the worst of these two. The Korean public servants are anonymous, meaning that if we see something wrong, we can't you know, just point it out as wrong because it's explicitly forbidden in Gongren and Fu Fa in the public service law. And on the other hand, if we want to whistleblow or to keep the elected officials in check, we can't do that. In the 政府咨询公开法, in the public information law, it explicitly says that if you have a policy in the making, it's not done, you should not release it to the public. Otherwise, well, you're violating the public information law. But it has a clause that says, 为公益所必要者的公开之, if you can prove that it is for the public interest, then you can actually open the data before you finalize your decisions and to ask people, not just elected officials, to check elected officials' ideas. But you have to prove that it's necessary for public interest. And if you combine that with Gongren and Fu Fa, it's a civil servant law, which says, if a higher up civil servant think it's not for public interest, then the down the lower level public servant have to agree with Zhang Guan's interpretation. Then it creates a very risk averse environment, because even if you think that it is for the public interest, if any of your bosses think it's not, well, it's not, and you're not supposed to talk about it before the policy is made. So the combining these two things means that Korean public servants often work very hard to solve a lot of very concrete problems and propose some very good ideas. But if these ideas are thought as, you know, bad, or, you know, the elected officials change their mind, or somebody higher up change their mind, well, these are silenced forever, and the public never knows about it. And then you end up doing a lot of, you know, redundant work again on the new direction, on another new direction, and so on. So this creates a kind of meaningless job because you keep doing a lot of very creative work for essentially nothing. And then, of course, it means that career public servants are often critiqued by the outside, by external stakeholders, as reacting too slowly, as not being responsive enough. But they did not know that there's these legal frameworks that prevents us from responding in a timely fashion. It needs approval all the way to the ministry before, you know, you can use and answer anything. So, which means that the esteem of public servants, both internally and also externally, the public perception, are pretty bad. But it's not like we didn't do our job professionally. It's just the existing communication framework prevents career public servants from directly answering and even being held accountable by the public. They had to go to the intermediary of the ministers, of elected officials, and of MPs, of legislators, and so on, and the media, of course, before it reaches the people. So whatever the career public servants does is misinterpreted or abstracted or whatever, misdirected for five different steps before it reaches the people. And when the people find something that they want to contribute, and the Korean public servants sometimes actually agrees with the people on the street, they could not directly communicate. And so, based on the experiments that Mayor Cohen just did in Taipei City during participatory budgeting, the civil society, the GovZero movement, helped to build a participatory budgeting website before the PB actually starts in Taipei. It shows, if you go to budget.taipei, it shows an interactive picture of Taipei's annual budget. And what this does is that it makes it fun to look at the Taipei City budget. And then if you care about one particular part of it, for example, the Ministry of the Bureau of Transportation, well, it has this amount of budget, which translates to some amount of lunchboxes. And you can look at the details and why it's added, why it's removed, and you can do a full text search, and so on. And then, and it's useful because not many people care about the total city budget. Many people only care about the one part of the budget that they care about. And so when we first put it on, next to each of those items in this bubble graph or in this tree graph, there is a discussion board so that people can talk about any kind of budget that they want. As you can see, there's a commentary board here. So what this does is that it allows people to talk exactly about one part of budget that they talk about. And this is what we call a social object. It used to just be page, 200 in the 500 PDF file, right? In a 500 page PDF file. But now it has its own web link that you can share to your LINE or Facebook friends and then ask people to come here and have a discussion on this particular round of budget. Now, when this platform first went online, people asked a lot of questions, had a lot of discussion among themselves. But much to their surprise, 3 weeks after the platform opens, every single question was answered by every single bureau in Taipei City. And not by elected officials, by Korean public servants. So the Korean public servants went here, and then with the blessing of their mayor, answered every single question one by one. And of course, the Department of Information Technology, the DOIT, in Taipei City did work with all the bureaus and instructed them how to answer to the people's questions on the internet. So what they did was essentially they bypassed their directors, the mayor, the city council, and had a direct link between the Korean public servants and people who have questions that they want to ask about the budget with the Korean public servants. And it's not a general discussion. It's a discussion, sometimes very professionally, about one particular part of the budget. And so the people who asked questions found that the city officials, the Korean public servants, are actually very professional. They were able to answer their questions not just timely, but in a very sympathetic and a very helpful fashion. And when people asked, okay, you promised to build a stadium here, what's the seminar here, and so on, they actually received very considerate answers. And for the Korean public servants, it's better than answering the mailbox of the mayor. Not because that they have to type as the mayor and not themselves, although that also is a difference, is that their responses are public. So the next person who has the same question would not need to ask twice. And their time is saved because they can bookmark this link and then share it whenever anybody else has the same question. So it also saves their time. But much more importantly, it allows the Korean public servants to be seen as professionals, and the people who ask questions eventually builds a good relationship with the Korean public servants who have participated. And so far, this is the main difference between the Taipei City installation of the visualization of the city budget versus the other six or seven different counties and cities who also installed the same system but did not let their current public servants answering it. So you see a very, very different feel. The other cities and counties, the current public servant did not think that this system has much to do with their job. But in Taipei City, during those 3 weeks and the weeks that followed, people think that, oh, this is something that actually improves what the society thinks of us. So that's my answer. Well, we have a lot more questions. Let's see. Oops, I misarchived something. Right, so this question is about something about my team. How do I work together and how do we discuss issues? Sure, gladly. I don't know if we have sound here, but there is a movie that we made, our teammate rather, about our team. So if you go to pdis.taiwan, which is our team's website, it's a government website. You can translate it to Chinese here. And it talks about the work that we did for participation, transparency, and accountability. And this here says terrific, responsible. But if you click Chinese translation, it will translate to something funny. 了不起负责, or something like that. Right? So, right. So, and then here we have a movie, but looks like I need to disable my AD blocker. Just a second. Oops. Oh, well, too bad. I will just show you some photos then. Right. So, our team is around 15 people in the administration. And we work in a very transparent fashion, meaning that every single meeting that I hold, every visit, every interview, everything is public. So all the meetings that I hold, all the talks and everything is kept here. And so you can just click on any of those transcripts and see exactly what has transpired in all the meetings that I held. And if you go to the accountability part of the website, it also shows that the policies that I'm involved in as QR code, for example, the eSport. And then it shows the policy context of the formation of the esports policies. And the important thing here is that this is not done after the fact. This website was already there during the negotiations and the talk. So whereas in the normal meeting minutes, you will only see 主席才是, right? You will only see the decisions from the chair, which is this part. Here, you see also what everybody's contributions before. How exactly did we arrive to the decisions? And so, and it also links to the next meeting. And so if you click the next meeting, it then goes to the following meeting. And so the idea here, the work principle here, is that for everybody who enters my office for a meeting or anything like that, I ask them to accept the fact that everything, every single thing they said will be turned into a transcript like this. Sometimes we record it and type it afterwards. Sometimes we work with a very fast typist who can type around 350 Chinese characters per minute. So she types faster than I speak. Right. So we work with the transcripts in this way, not like live stream. You know. We make the transcript. We send usually a day or two after the meeting to everybody in the same room, and then we ask them to edit collaboratively this document. This has two benefits. First, in many meetings, if you're itching to say something, sometimes you don't hear other people's arguments that well. And if you go back a day or two afterwards after having a good night's sleep, sometimes when you're reviewing the transcript, you see very good arguments that was made and you kind of just skipped during the meeting. And second, it holds everybody accountable. If one of the deputy directors or a deputy minister even go to the meeting and promise that, okay, we will do this and that in 10 days, but if she or he then goes back and tell their staff, okay, we're going to deliver this and that, there's sometimes differences between what they promised in the meeting and what they told the ministry to do, and we never find out until the next meeting, and they produce something else entirely. But now, because we can very easily forward their staff and their staff's staff the entire transcript, they can check their directors, their deputy ministers, once and see it in context. See why did she or he promise that? And why is this, you know, promised? And whether this promise is actually against physical law, whether it's impossible, then they will be able to find a much more useful alternative instead of just, you know, biting the bullet and doing actually the wrong thing. So we found out this is not just for transparency's sake. This actually improves people's behavior because they will not promise something that they know they couldn't deliver if they know that this transcript is going to be public. And their staff is then much more empowered because they know exactly the context in which this decision is made. And this is actually even much more useful in things like e-sport, because it was not a purview of any single ministry. The Yunchan Tiaoli, the tax deduction and everything, that is part of the Ministry of Education. And the alternate service, Tidai, is part of the Ministry of Culture. And 学校可开设专门课程, is again the Ministry of Education, but it also requires help from the Ministry of Economy Affairs and so on. And of course, the alternate service also requires help from the Ministry of Interior. And then because this is about tax deduction, it also needs input from the Ministry of Finance. So it actually involves many ministries. And if they only get one fragment of their decisions, their first response would be saying, this is not my business. And actually, the eSport case was, for 6 years, was like this. It's in a limbo. It's in a nobody's zone. All the ministry says, eSport is not my business, right? Because this really requires five or so ministries, each claiming one small part of responsibility. But they could not do it collaboratively if they know that afterwards, anybody is free to just throw away whatever they said in the meetings, right? And so people who want to take some responsibility will then end up take all the responsibility that they could not deliver. And we see that a lot in the public service. So the style that we work as a team is to make sure that everything is published 10 work days after each meeting, usually 2 weeks. And within those 2 weeks, every participant collaboratively edit, not just to soften the words and so on, but to think deeply together what their roles are in this kind of collaborative environment. So my team, the public digital team, the PDIS team, the public digital innovation space in the administration basically just provides a space for people in any ministry who are interested in this kind of collaborative policy making to join. Because as a minister without portfolio, although I'm the digital minister, I don't have a digital ministry, right? So all I have as permanent staff is just two executive assistants. But because I say, okay, here is the space, and I welcome everybody who volunteer to join this space, they could just email me, and I didn't even know them. And they said, okay, please just ask me to work on site, like 借调, mean to your office. And then so like people referred their friends and so on. So I ended up 借调ing like 12 people. And so their salaries and everything are still being paid by their original ministries or their original institutes, but they work on site. And the best thing about this arrangement is that when we're designing new systems for their ministries, they will be able to evaluate based on the perspective as a career public servants. If I have hired 15 contractors, they will not have between them like hundreds of years of public service expertise to evaluate whether these workflow actually improves the quality of life of career public servants. So this is how the PDS team is formed. So our next question. Our next question is about, is there any generational gap between me and my colleague in the cabinet, since I'm the youngest and a lot younger than other ministers? That's a fair question. There's a popular rumor that says I'm the youngest minister ever in this government. It's not. When Minister Zheng Yijun became part of the cabinet heading the Youth Council, back when she was first entering the cabinet many years ago, she was 1 year younger than me, so I'm not the youngest. But I'm the youngest in the current cabinet, though. Because this is something that I observed when I worked with my grandma, my two grandmas, my father's mother and my mother's mother. They were both very active on the internet. And they had some issues typing on keyboards, although they were very willing to learn. But once iPad gets invented, they were like extremely fluent in using the touch gestures and everything. And they do have a lot of stories to share, and they have a lot of active footprint on the internet. They have a lot more free time also. So the idea here is not about age, it's about willingness to engage with people who are different than you, to be open in your mind. And if there are some technical difficulties in, for example, using the mouse or using the keyboard, well, that is a problem of us, of us designers, of us information technology workers. We need to design our interface so that it's more natural. And so when I brought my grandma one of those virtual reality tourism toolkit, she requires no learning, because in virtual reality, you just use your hands to move around or fly around or something. It is something that everybody have been learning since we were little babies, right? It is much easier than typing, than using a mouse. All these we learned after we were 7 years old or something, or 5 years old. But you know, to walk, to point to things and so on, we learned since we were like 1 year old or something. So it is our job as designers to make it very easy to include more people. And I don't think it is a generational gap here if we make it easy enough and easy to learn enough for people to engage. So under a so-called open government, how can we protect the classified data, the confidential information, national secrets? Of course, there needs to be national secrets and confidential information. Actually, we have a law, 国家机密法, that defines exactly how classified information should be handled. And so when I know that I'm going to enter this cabinet working on the open government, I made a deal with Premier Lin Chen. I said, you can let me work on open government. I'm very happy to work on open government. But because I will essentially turn everything I hear into text, into data, and have machines learning from the data, doing analysis, the national confidential law, 国家机密法, defines that if you have a system and you have many input to the system, if any of those input is classified data, the output is classified data. And I can't do open government anymore because, well, some classified data went in. So I asked the premier, never let me see confidential information. Any document that was marked meet them or something like that, I don't even open the envelope. There is a counselor, there's a 参事 in my office who is cleared for confidential stuff like that. So he handles all the confidential document. I don't even see it. So this is the way that I can automate my work, my everyday work, because by definition, anything that I can see is subject to the freedom of information law in Taiwan, 资讯公开法. Of course, a lot of it is pre-decisional draft work.That says, you know, only open them if you find it necessary for public interest. 公益有必要 But, well, because my work is open government, it's always necessary for the public interest because it's my job. And because, you know, I only have one boss and he agrees with me. So I don't have to get approval. So anything that passes my way, by default, gets opened. So this is my work principle. So we protect by having a separate workflow system, an air gap, if you will, between me and confidential data. And this is how it should be. All the confidential data need to be handled by explicitly marking them as confidential and released after, say, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. And so there is a temptation working in the government to hoard, to protect every single thing, and then just open selectively. But this doesn't work, because if you only open up certain data or certain documents on public pressure, like they ask you to release data and then you release it, they never know whether you change the data or you selectively just publish things to calm people down. But on the other hand, if you open up everything except for the classified things, then people usually trust you because it's, for example, we released the pricing data of the vegetables and so on starting a few months from now.But we do it before a typhoon hits. Because if we start releasing the pricing of vegetables when typhoon hits, everybody would say, okay, we do it on response to people's accusation of vegetable worms or something like that, right? But if we start publishing it well before the typhoon hits, people build a trust into the system we use for publication. Because, well, we do it every day. It's not like we do it in response to typhoon. And this is the only way that I know ofto regain public trust is just to open and publish things by default. So another question says, is open government mainly about forming policy procedure? Yes and no. As we see in the conceptual diagram, the policy procedure is part of it, but the other important thing is to enable collaboration, not between government and people, but between different units in the government, which is sometimes even more difficult than between government and people. The many units that I approached said that they're very much willing to work with people, but they don't want to work with this ministry or that unit for some reason. So this is very interesting because in the national government, I don't know that much about regional government. In the national government, we're very good at division of labor. Anything that appears on the news, you can see a very, very quick, like tree walking schedule that just the ministry is saying, okay, it's that ministry's business, and the ministry says, okay, it's this bureau's business, and then it's this unit's business, and so on. And so finally, it finds the changban, the person responsible for this kind of thing. But we're so good at division of labor that we're not very good at collaboration. So if something really happens that really requires input from many units and many offices and so on, unless it is one of those very, very important policies, those VIPs, that we have a huibao for that. Otherwise, if we ask people who are involved, okay, so you're responsible for maybe one third of it. What was the other 66%? Who are the people you think that we should talk to? And they're like, I don't know. So this is very, very interesting that we're very good at handling the division of labor, but not that good at collaboration. So this actually, for me, is the first priority. Before we work with people, we need to work with our colleagues. And then, of course, once we are able to work with our colleagues, we can then work with people during the policy formation. And finally, maybe instead of saying, okay, I have an idea, I ask people to improve my idea, Maybe for some topics, we can say, I have no idea. And then people tell me what to do. For new experimental policies, for example, one of the new policies that we're working on at the moment, they copy, for example, your health record, right? So these kind of personal data, this kind of privacy-related data, should not be open by default, and we're very clear on this. And then the second thing is the drafts, when the policy is still forming. Of course, if people are asking for live streaming of all the meetings that everybody has in the administration, it will cause a lot of difficulty in everyday policy making, because the current generation of live streaming puts a lot of power to the person holding the camera. If you're looking into the camera, your context, your nonverbal expression, your hands, your face, and so on, gets a lot more attention. But people who are not in the middle of the video basically get sidelined, even though you know they also have important contributions. And they are much more prone to be taken out of context. So which is why we use a more fair, at least I think, method of textual transcript that is collaboratively edited by everybody. First, because we need to make a meeting minute anyway, right? We need to make a meeting record anyway. So why not let everybody check the chair instead of just letting the chair decide? And second, because of this delay, people can think much more thoroughly of what happened. If everybody has to review a 3-hour video of every meeting, we'll spend all our days reviewing our yesterday's meetings and we don't have to do anything else, right? And it will just occupy everybody's time. So although in theory people can ask them to be opened, in practice we need to open it in a way that actually saves the time of the people producing it, the people processing it, and the people using it. If we increase the cost too much in any of the three parties, and even maybe make the other two parties' life easier, it will not last long, because then people don't have an incentive of participating in the open government. So we try to design a workflow that it saves the time, or at least keep the same time expense as before, for people who originate, who make the data, for people who process the data, and for people who use the data. How would the idea of open government solve the values conflict issue, for example, the same-sex marriage issue? There seems to no mutual trust can be found within these conflicts. I disagree. The thing here is, personally, I don't care about marriage. But people who care about marriage, be they gay people or straight people, I think they have more in common between themselves and with me. Because I don't care about marriage, and they do care. And then if they care about the sanctity of marriage, the seriousness of marriage, because people get divorced a lot here in Taiwan. If people care about marriage, that means something, that's one part of people. And if people care about equality of marriage, like that they want to enjoy some sort of long-term relationship that may or may not be called marriage, right? I think these two kinds of people have a lot more in common. They share essentially the same value. It's just the value was implemented differently, or maybe in an exclusive way. So I actually agree with President Tsai in saying that some common ground may be found. Maybe after talking to each other, we will discover that it's just one side don't want the other side's marriage to be called marriage, but sometimes they are fine if it's called gay marriage. Okay, maybe we call it gay marriage, but the important thing is the equality, that they must enjoy the more or less the same right as each other. And this is what these kind of people care about. And many people in the Catholic or Christian faith didn't actually oppose to that, as long as it's not called marriage. My grandma's Catholic, so in any case, the fact that we were able to talk on these specific terms speak to the political idea called overlapping consensus. The political idea of overlapping consensus means that if you talk about abstract things, sharing economy, human right, then it is like religion. people will fight very bitterly because the same word means very different things to different camps. But if you talk about one very, very narrow practical issue, for example, if you are a private driver and you want to, you know, earn some money by driving strangers around on your way back home, but you don't have a professional driver's license, should you get a professional driver's license and insurance? So instead of talking sharing economy, we talk about one very specific policy aspect. And then magically, you find people who shout at each other, start having rational discussions. Because no matter what their values were, they were able to agree on the practicalities. Like, this is more practical than the other solutions and so on. But if you expand the topic too much so that it becomes abstract, then of course people don't manage to agree because none of us can hold these huge issues in our mind. So we just take one small part of it and start fighting over each other. So it doesn't work, of course, if you try to phrase it as a, you know, value contest. But if you just talk about very specific parts and aspects of the policies, we usually can actually find a common understanding. So what we should change in mental attitude? Well, I would just say open to change, and that's it. The idea is just listening. When I listen, I basically say that I'm willing to be changed. In Mandarin, we say 倾听. 倾 means tilting, like I'm willing to be put off balance by what I heard from you. And if I'm put off balance, I'm aware that I'm being put off balance. I try to merge the ideas that I heard from you and the ideas I already have, and then I try to restore balance somehow, and then I share with you how exactly I was caught off balance and what I changed inside myself, taking your input into account. So this kind of 倾听 and 沟通, I think is key to open government, because essentially it means trusting strangers, trusting people who you have never met to nevertheless have some contribution to the work that you're working on. And this requires, of course, a lot of practice, but also a lot of dialogue and a lot of communication. So that is the main mental attitude change. The other question is like, what kind of topic or issue should be discussed or not? That's a fair question, and I will make some examples. So, as part of our monthly meeting, the 32 different ministries or commissions in the administration each have one, two, or three participation officers responsible for delivering the open government plan within their own ministry. And they're kind of our seats who starts collaborating in this kind of regular way. And every month, we meet and we report what we have done in the past months about open government, and then we also talk about things that should be talked about. So what kind of policies are good for open government? The things are good if they are not yet analyzed into specific problems. That is to say, if they lack consensus. If there is already very clear consensus that this thing really requires doing, and the only thing to fight is what kind of implementation technique is good, or what color is better, and that's the only thing at stake. Of course, it's not good for open government, because people would spend hours to read through everything that happened, and discover that the only thing they can suggest is the color of the building. Of course, it would feel like cheating their time, and then people would not like to participate. So the earlier in the policy-making cycle, the better and the best one are the ones that the government, the Korean public servants, have no idea what to do. So for these kind of cases, if we use the ordinary waterfall method of policy-making, we would then select just one part of the view out of many of the views, essentially ignore the rest, usually because the elected officials didn't have friends with these stakeholders. And then design a workflow by career public servants, and then the contractors or the Changban design a system, and then it goes right into the maintenance, the legitimization part, and then maybe it gets passed as a regulation. And then the other stakeholders then discover it because it's already regulation affects everybody. And they were taken by surprise and sometimes go to the streets. But if we become aware that there is very little consensus, and then we don't try to force this through, then we move the users from step 6 all the way to step 1. And then we try to involve people saying, okay, we really have no idea, so let's get some ideas. And then, because the users manage to get some consensus, we design services, not systems, based on this consensus. And then start piloting, start testing. So, for example, in our initial meeting back in February, we had some consensus camps. And we used a very interesting case that the government at that point, back in January, kind of ran through without asking all the stakeholders. Some of you may already know that. It is the case of the National Travel Card. The National Travel Card is a credit card that all the public servants have, or more or less, right? It enables you to have up to 16,000 NT dollars per year to be spent traveling, but also other things. But last December, the rule was changed so that one half of the 16,000 NT dollars must now only be spent on group travel. On buses or on whatever, right? And while you can keep the other part, the other half for, solo traveling. But while people were very unhappy about this back when the National Travel Plan was announced, and so back in January, we had to do a U-turn that says, okay, maybe it's a bad idea. Now you can just spend the other 8,000 also on solo travel. Sorry about that. But this kind of U-turn is not good for the morale of the public servant. And so the participation officers in our open government team did a brainstorm to analyze the problems of the National Travel Card, the insights, and the challenges. And then a lot of very good points gets raised. For example, the name National Travel Card is very misleading. And then in any case, 5 out of 8 groups in the participation offices highlighted the lack of internal participation as the key reason of why the National Travel Card was, the plan was so unpopular. And so these were the post-it notes that our participation offices have came about for the National Travel Card case. So, of course, we're not just criticizing. As people working on open government, we always collaborate, meaning, okay, so if we're now doing it again, how can we do better? And then using these idea development techniques, we end up saying, okay, how can we introduce a more innovative open culture and with blessing from the elected officials to help all the public servants to share a public and transparent way of discussion, to have a thorough discussion and a lot of back and forth to reach consensus and to improve the quality of decision that affects all the public service people, such as the National Travel Card. So once you phrase the issues this way, it is not about National Travel Card anymore. It is about a general problem that the communications within the internal government that people have. And so we did a lot of idea development with drawings and everything. But then we refined these ideas into a design for a system that needs to protect people's privacy. People need to be able to post pseudonymously. And then it allowed people to talk about things that affect their rights. And then this is the back end, the front end requirements of such a system. And if for example, 300 people, 300 public servants petition to get something discussed, it should be responded, verified within 3 days, and then gets into a feasibility evaluation. And then we need to talk about how to consolidate similar asking, and then how to ensure that it gets a real discussion within a month, and then how it need to involve the professionals and also the people who proposed, and that people who did propose good ideas in these platforms need to be rewarded somehow. So all this is done in an afternoon between the participation officers in this ideation workshop. And so it's translated into a regulation. As of last month, the National Development Council took the pictures that we generated in the brainstorming session. And then we took it to Premier, because I meet the Premier and other ministers with our portfolio every Monday. Every Friday, we will have one discussion on open government, on one policy. And the topics that we discuss is voted on by the participation officers in all the ministries. So it's not that I care about something, I choose it. No, people do a petition, for example, on national travel card. And then the participation officers vote on the things that they think requires the most attention. And then we work on the things that they voted on every Friday. And then, every Friday, we produce that kind of design document, and I brief the Premier the following Monday. And then if the Premier says, okay, go for it, then it becomes something like this that gets translated into regulations. And so, for example, for this particular case, the internal participation system, the National Development Council translated the design into a concrete case. And it is in the process of being implemented. We're just working on the RFPs at the moment, so that in a few months, there will be a system that is prototyping that we will use to allow participation, not just from general public, but internally from the civil service people working on their rights and their welfare. So this is to answer the question. This is to design a mechanism to decide the kind of topic that should be discussed. So this is during our voting. As you can see, the union of public servants are considered the most important case by the participation officers back in our first monthly meeting. And we did actually work on it. So, the next question. There are many procedures, administration, now government. Do you think public servants are limited too much by too much law? Well, this is a fair question. I think it's like this. If a law is predictable in the sense that you always know what is, you know, allowed and what is not allowed, then it doesn't take that much time of you to think through it. A lot of problem that I encounter as a first advisor and now as a minister is that there's many laws, such as the Freedom of Information Law, that requires some kind of value judgment, like 对公义有必要. But this burden of proof is not very clearly delineated, it's not very clearly defined, so that people have to actually work it on a case-by-case method using their best judgment. Now, this is actually a good thing, because people should use their judgment. But because of the culture, I would say, not the law, when people are trying to use their own judgment to deal with cases that previously were unheard of in public service, the first thing that they think of is that, okay, whether they're HR, they're 人事, whether they're corrective units, the 政风, or whether they will get the approval from their 主计, from their accounting, and so on, because it's new, it's not happened before. So they will think that they need a very secure position and between all the checks and balances before this, they were even raised the idea. But when I actually talk to the 人事主计 and 政风 people, they were like, well, it sounds like a good idea. nobody ever mentioned it to them, though. So this is a cultural thing. People actively self-censor, worrying that there might be a risk of getting, you know, taken out of town, getting singled out, getting, you know, punished for something that they did not do. So this is, I think, more of a culture, not a law thing, that limits people from proposing innovative ideas or to do cross-unit communication. So a lot of the work, the team building that I'm doing in administration is really about culture. I think even within the current framework of law, we can do a lot of collaboration, a lot of very innovative policy making if we learn to trust each other more, not just trusting the people more. Okay, shall we take a 10-minute break? Let's do this. So this is 25 now, so let's go back in 35. TW. The question here is, which website do I serve? Do I think open information is true? That's two questions. So one of the websites that I very much frequent is join.gov.tw. And it is the kind of public participation portal of the government at the moment. If you go to join.gov.tw, you see that there's now the administration and then the auditing ministry and also regional governments. In a few months, I'm told that the legislative yuan will also open its portal based on join.gov.tw. So it's very interesting because it now has the coverage of 4/5 of our constitutional system. So just in the administration branch, the executive branch, you can see three parts. The first part, called purpose, is the proposal from people for us to think about. If you go to the proposal, for example, and look at the thing that has already been responded to, you see some very good ideas here, actually. For example, you see here that the government should cancel the National Travel Card. And it was countersigned by 7,535 people. And so the rule of the petition platform is that any petition topic that gets 5,000 countersignatures must be responded within 60 days by the administration. So as you can see, there is actually a very nuanced response. So the first response saying, we thank the proposer, we got your counter signatures. And the very next day, Audrey, that's me, worked with a lot of different ministries to try to get a hold of who is responsible for this case and who should help. And then we promise that we will contact the proposer, we will collect relevant information and data and open it, and then we will meet with the people who hold this petition to get their concrete ideas. And then within 2 months, we will respond with what we have done. And the next says that, okay, we have emailed the person bringing up the petition and they have replied. And their reply saying the main thing, the fourth thing that he asks for is these things. And so we have clarified the concrete demands, but we want the other 7,000 people to know. And then, 3 days later, we published the previously hidden reports of the previous year's National Travel Card and the internal surveys and gatherings that was formed the basis of the decision making around the national travel card. It was not published、to the press release back in December, although I think they should.、but at least during the petition, these documents are now sent to the 7,000 people.Now, armed with、factual information, everybody have read through what has happened before, the next announcement again sent to the mailbox of 7,000 people says, okay, Audrey is now holding a workshop、February 22, and then we ask the petitioner and at most five、counter-signature people, the five supporters, into this face-to-face meeting so that we can collaboratively design.What to do with the petition. Because this is the first、open government workshop,、people don't have a reason to trust us. So at the end, only two people came. The next one was better, three people came. And then the next one, five people came. So it's an improvement. So、two of the 7,000 petitioners did come. And then、we had a very long discussion、and a collaborative ideation.We found that the petitioner was very angry when they heard that the national travel card costs、government money, that is a reward, and if we、take it off,、the government will save a lot of money. So we actually did a factual tallying and then announced officially that actually the national travel card is for the administration to saveon the extra time expenses. Because in exchange for a national travel card, you now have to actually、you know, go out of、on vacation 14 days a year. If you don't, you don't get anything in return. But the idea is that it's an exchange. It's not a reward. So the exchange, actually, the administration saves a lot of money.By initiating this exchange. So at least it addressed the part that people mistake the national travel card as a reward. It's not, it's a money saving device. And then、people started asking what are the impacts. And then we came up with raw figures. And then people asked about the name itself, which is a pretty inaccurate name.And so we said, okay, once we have the internal join system, the internal participation system, we can use the system to ask around and what kind of the better name people think、should be for the national travel card. And so we did not actually say yes to everything. Notably, we did not cancel the national travel card.But it is not a zero-sum game. It is not something that they win and we lose or something. We all learned something when doing this kind of evidence-based discussion. People would stop saying the government spends, you know, Baxi on national travel card. Nor would they say the government saves Baxi on national travel card. Both sides were, you know, arguing from...not exactly、factual things last December. So at least we have some common ground. We know exactly what the National Travel Card is about, what its effects are. Maybe it's not the best design, but we can improve it. Or if we have to cancel it, well, we now know the cost of canceling it, and so on. So although this is, so、I would reiterate, the petition platform is not about meeting the demand.Every single demand of people who muster 5,000 counter signature. It is for people who spend a lot of time thinking about the government should do and the government have missed. We promised to spend at least equal amount of time to understand what they're talking about, to come up with some reasonable explanation, to come up with factual data that everybody can enjoy, and even more importantly,asking people who have different ideas from these petitioners and still come to something that is consensus that everybody can agree with. So this is the real、thing. This is not、a substitute for voting. We don't vote in the petition part, but this is agenda setting. It means that the government need to think about these things. Well, maybe they have missed. So this is the proposed part. And then the next part is the top part. It is a announcement of every single regulation. 60 days before its announcement goes here. So the idea, very simply put, is that people will not be taken by surprise. Every single regulation before it takes effect must wait for 60 days here for people to put their input, their questions, their inquiries, everything about it. And it's not always, so we couldn't predict which kind of acts will get hot or get people's interest, but we will just publish every single thing. So let me show you some examples. So this is a long tail thing, right? The most response we get was on the gay marriage stuff and the EID stuff and the criminalization of adultery, smoking, and so on. But even if not that controversial, for example, the NDC was planning a Foreign Talent Act to encourage more foreign professional talent to work and live in Taiwan. This keeps to today's lessons topic, because this is the only one in English. So basically, the NDC circulates a draft of their act. And you do actually see a lot of foreign talents. They may work as teachers, as professionals, as all kind of workers. And you can see at a glance that everybody agrees about the second part, that the relaxation of law relating to foreign professional spouses and children. It's like everybody is for it. And they're generally for the other relaxations. But there's many people who think the definition of what construe as special professional, foreign professional, is too vague, too ambiguous. And so the NDC therefore renewed their definitions based on the sometimes very good suggestions here. As you can see, people would write a lot, and the Ministry of Interior would write even more. So there's a lot of real discussions happening with the foreign talents and here and in the administration. And again, we see the same dynamic as in the Taipei City open budget case. The career civil servants who participate in this discussion feel that their work is being appreciated. And the foreign talents communities online and offline see this as something that they've never thought that the Taiwanese government would do. They would actually provide input, and people would actually take their input and then make it into policy. So this actually is a very good public relationship even between the NDC and the other participating ministries and the foreign talents. Of course, there's youth housing, and there's many other things, the copyright law, and so on. So this is the second part. So the first part is people setting the agenda of government, and the second part is the government asking people's ideas of future policies. The third part, the supervised part, this is a budget visualization. And again, the same code as the Taipei City budget. But this is not all the ministries. At the moment, it is only the ministries who have participated in the important administration level policies. So these are the things that we care the most about, even though they only need to update their progress every quarter, every 3 months. But these actually we keep a very close eye. We review every couple of weeks on many items here. So you see the open data and digital inclusion, the agriculture and everything here. So long-term care, underground water, and so on. So if you go to, for example, the underground water part, then you can see it's the money that it has spent, the goals, the KPIs that it has fulfilled, what kind of project it is, the abstract of the project, the key work for this season, for this quarter, and what kind of subcontracts and so on they have handed out, that this is actually a six-year plan, it's only a third year, and then you too can provide your input on the part of the plan that you care about. So we don't expect people to just jump in and provide us with a lot of feedback. This was just online for a week now. But this provides a very convenient address for each of those long-running projects. So people who do care about this can just press watch or bookmark and receive all the quarterly updates of these projects. And if you happen to care a lot about any of these part of things, well, now you have a direct line to the public servant in charge of this particular project. So again, this is about the ongoing projects. So the ideation part, the regulation announcement part, and finally, after regulation actually becomes a national project, we have the supervision part. So this covers most of the life cycle of the public policy. So this is the answer. This is the website that I serve the most, because most of our innovations and our dialogue and so on ends up going on to that website. So do I think open information is always true? No. But open information is there. It is open meaning that you're free to circulate it. That if I post something into the public, I cannot take it down anymore. And I promise not to sue you, because it's part of the open license. And the idea is not just you can read it, but you can also adapt it. A lot of the pretty pictures that we see during the budget visualization and so on are actually just data. These are just numbers kept by the auditing committees and so on. But because it's open data, people don't just read it as part of a page or a printout. Instead, people who are into programming can just take those numbers and make pretty pictures. It's not just join.gov.tw. Anybody can take the same open data and make pretty pictures and make much more easy to understand the applications. So it's not about true or false. It's about the maximum utility of data. And if you look at it and you see something wrong, well, you can talk with the person in charge of that project and asking them to correct the number. Whereas before, it may be buried in the, you know, the 300th page of a 500 page PDF document, and nobody will never notice it. So it's just getting data much more flexibility. Uber is a co-sharing traffic concept. That's actually not true. Uber pool has never run in Taiwan. Whereas in France and in other regions, it is possible for you to call a Uber and go onto a Uber car and find somebody else is already there. It's called carpooling. It shares multiple people in the same car. Uber has never introduced carpooling in Taiwan. So I wouldn't say Uber in Taiwan a co-sharing traffic concept. I would say it's a efficient car dispatch system. So, but the question was, so-called open government cannot accept it. How to explain? Well, first of all, we did not accept it. We accepted it for a due process of discussion. So this is a platform that I worked on before I joined gov.tw. This went up first. It's called vtaiwan.tw. JOIN is built by the National Development Council and maintained by the National Development Council. VTaiwan was not and is never maintained just by the administration. It's maintained by the GovZero community, by a lot of volunteers. So VTaiwan is collaboratively maintained by the civil society, by the private sector, and by the public sector. And here we talk about futuristic things that are related to digital economy and so on. So one of the historical cases that we did talk about was Uber. So if we But we also talk about Airbnb. So during the Airbnb and also during the Uber discussion, what we did was we invited all the stakeholders to view the slides collaboratively prepared by, well, pretty much everybody. And again, the reason why we talk about Uber or about Airbnb is because the participants voted for it. And so, let me see if I can maximize this. So people want to talk about Uber, and we did talk about Uber. And so we start briefing everybody Uber's legality at the time around the world. It was back in August 2015. And then we show a timeline to everybody of Uber Taiwan's development. And then we send people to this website called Polis, P-O-L.is, where people can see their avatar and then see one yes or no question proposed by a ministry or by their friends. And you can click yes or no. If you click yes or no, you move toward one of these groups of your Twitter and your Facebook friends. So what this does is that it shows you the spectrum of opinions of your Facebook and Twitter friends. And if you start voting, you will walk, literally, here, toward the people who share your opinion on Uber. And this is very interesting because, first, it shows that people are not enemies. These are all your Facebook friends. It's just you didn't talk about Uber over dinner. So these are not anonymous enemies, these are just your friends who happen to have different opinions. And the second thing is that, because unlike a questionnaire, all these yes or no questions are user contributed. So if you voted for like 9 times and decided that, okay, none of this describes my opinion, you can propose your own feeling here for other people to vote about. And then the system highlights the thing that has the most consensus, and we invite people to analyze independently. And we say, we will take as agenda to negotiate with Uber and Taiwan Taxi and the Association of Taxis in Taipei, because at that time Uber was only in Taipei and some part of Kaohsiung, of anything if you manage to convince 80% of people about it. So in the very beginning, people split into two groups on that picture with a very wide gap between the two groups. Group one says that Uber's license need to be cancelled immediately, and group two says, if I see taxi wishing before me, I will still call Uber. So as you can see, these are two very different kinds of people. But none of them manage, of course, to convince each other. And if you multiply 75 by 45%, you get into the low 20s. And we need 8% for it to become the agenda. So after a week, every group come up with a more eclectic, more nuanced idea. For example, the group one came up with the idea that, okay, it's not about Uber, it's about unlicensed car fleets, and the Ministry of Transport and Communication need to take care of these kind of things, their duty. Now there's more people supporting. And then the group two came up with something that says, okay, I think one taxi need to be able to join in multiple fleets. And currently the fleets are restricting the union power, and Uber strengthens the union power. And it managed to convince most people in group two. And just by proposing that, group two gained 2% of people, because some taxi driver gets convinced. But if you multiply 56% by 93%, it's still in the low 50s. It's still not 80%. So you still need to convince more people. So by the end of second week or so, we get some very vague ideas. This idea says, okay, I think it's a era of technology, regulations need to change. Of course, anyone here disagree? So people generally agree that regulations do need to change. And then another person said, okay, I think safeguarding, you know, the credibility, the certificate is important, the passenger's protection is important, the driver's right is also important, but safety is the most important. And everybody agrees with that, even though they disagree on everything else. So by the third week, we have some really good ideas. For example, Ivan Chen said, I think the government should pass a regulation that's just like Uber, that let the passenger and the driver rate each other, that let us enjoy a better quality of fleet service, and, you know, have Uber, you know, conform with this new regulation. And once Ivan posted it, even the Uber drivers agrees with him. And once he posted it, the original, this idea that says we don't negotiate with criminals, that this goes down. And people think, okay, we still need to talk with Uber somehow. So by the end of the 3.5 week period, we did get some overall consensus about fare regulation, about the taxation, about prominent display of this new kind of e-fleet, that it should still be the purview of the Ministry of Transport and Communication, that if you go to web and go back and ride share, maybe you shouldn't be taxed because it's just 2 times a day, but if you go to work and go home 50 times a day, well, it is actually just taxi, and you should be taxed like a taxi. And once all this is urban, it says, okay, existing taxi drivers should be allowed to still pick up people on the street, but also join one of those dynamic e-fleets. And these points, in addition with Ireland's one, formed the basis of the taxi diversification regulation, of the Duoyuan Jicheng Cheng Fang'an. The thing that the Ministry of Transport pushed is literally a translation of those consensus points into regulation, because the Ministry of Transport knows that even Uber drivers are good with these. Of course, we compared it with some international laws and so on, and then we invited everybody, like Uber and all the associations, into discussion. And they, if you look at the timeline, they actually agreed to the demands of the people. Here we see Uber's lawyer, Xie Shuyi. We see the Taiwan Taxi. We see the association people. We see a lot of professors, and so on. So, and all this is on the record. And then we can see a lot of promises that the Uber company did about insurance, about keeping records of their taxis, and much more importantly, helping the existing drivers to get professional driver's license, as long as they can solve the car obtainment problem and so on. So this is a very nuanced dialogue that then the Ministry of Transport took into the regulation. And so when Uber actually did a about face, a U-turn, 1 year afterwards in the new administration, this was back in the previous discussion, it was under Minister Jacqueline Tsai, Tsai Yuling. So when Uber argued that they no longer want to work with the drivers to help them to get professional driver's license, we can say to Uber this thing, but last year you said you would. So this is something that we repeatedly referred back when we negotiated with Uber, even in this administration, because it was a public promise, and they promised in front of thousands of people. Now, this is not saying that this procedure is perfect. In particular, because Uber was just operating in Taipei, in the greater Taipei city, and some part of Taoyuan at that moment, we did not include the associations of Kaohsiung, of Taichung, and other cities that Uber would then later go to. So a lot of the taxi associations and so on in southern cities feel that they were excluded in this open government policymaking procedure before. And so they went to the streets and so on and saying, you know, it's an unfair representation. And so, yeah, we really need to do it better next time if we're still tackling this. But it was the first, literally the first case that I participated using this technique, using real-time transcript and everything. So there's a lot of room for improvement, but Uber was the first case that we tried this kind of policy development. So, we have half an hour, so I will now maybe speak faster. All right. The next question pertains to the apps that I frequently use. Can I share my most frequently used 5 apps about my work? Right. So, as I explained, SunStorm, is the system that we use for everyday work in PDIS. It contains a chat room, cloud storage like Dropbox, a task management, collaborative document editing, and spreadsheets, and more. And we have set up, because this is free software and very secure at that, we set up a copy ourselves inside the administration and then provides it to all the public servants. So if you happen to have a gov.tw email address, you can actually go to, let me find somewhere to write, ey.pdis.nationalgovernment.taiwan. And then you can register and then just start using the tools. Next month, we will be recording a set of video courses about how to use these tools, how to set it up, and so on. But for the time being, you can go to talk.pdis.tw, which is our forum, and see the handbooks that we have prepared for our participation offices. So that's the second most used app that I use. It's called Discourse. It's a discussion forum. So if you go to TalkPDIS Taiwan, you will see not only the track records and all the questions that the reporters ask me and so on, but you will also see the Open Government Frequently Asked Questions and our introductory handbooks for the SunStorm environment and for PDIS, and it will list exactly who are PDIS at the moment in the administration. You're welcome to join, by the way. It will also show, if you happen to be a participation officer in the ministry, it provides you with some instructions of how to become a participation officer in your unit. And so, yeah, there's a lot of things there. So, well, take your time. But if you ever got stuck or something, feel free to ask us questions and we'll try to answer very quickly on the forum. So SunStorm and the forum are the two most frequent apps that I use. Otherwise, I'm pretty much just like everybody. I use GoodNotes Mac and on iPad to do this kind of presentation and real-time note-taking and things like that. That's three. The fourth is called OmniFocus. The one on the lower right corner. It's a task management system that I use. And then finally, I use Firefox Focus, which is a web browser that not only blocks all the advertisements and blocks, well, pretty much virus and Trojan and everything, but also erase the history, the time I close this tab, so I can share this tablet with everybody in PDIS without leaking my browsing history and things like that. So that's answer to your question. What else? How do you think it was set online customer service in all government agencies? That's a very interesting question. Well, first of all, not all government agencies are customer facing. For example, 主基础 has a very different customer profile than the Ministry of Interior, of Health Minister, of Health and Welfare, and things like that. So I'm not sure that online customer service is always the most useful if your customer are not usually online. But if your customers are usually online, then yes, it can be useful. And this is actually one of the last parts of join.gov.tw that we have not yet redesigned. It's called 找手展. At the moment, it just goes to all the ministry's email boxes. So whereas you can, you know, write to the Ministry of Labor, of Health and Welfare, and so on, usually it just goes back to the same person answering the phone calls and you know, the emails and online CSM and whatever. So if you you know, improve the system so that it makes it easier for people to write customer service, you basically just make that person or that team go to work earlier and go home later, because you essentially just increase the workload. So one of the ideas that we're entertaining is to get all the ministries that who wants participation some kind of frequently asked questions, so that people don't have to answer the same question twice. And so a lot of those question that I personally answer as the digital minister. People ask if I'm afraid of ghosts, ask what kind of toothbrush that I use, and so on. But no matter how fantastic is the question, I answer them nevertheless. But I answer them only once, which means if you post another question, whether I use electronic toothbrush or regular toothbrush, the system will show that, hey, this question somebody asked before, and the minister actually has answered this before. They should have used both, apparently. It's normal toothbrushes. So it saves everybody's time, because I only have to answer it once. You can share the links of my answer, and if you ask the same question or even just a very similar question, the system will ask you whether you know you mean this and it has been answered before. So I save time overall. So I'm trying to see how many other ministries is interested in this kind of FAQ. Of course, when people ask questions, sometimes they reveal their personal details, and of course we need to remove them when we publish it. So it requires some workflow. But more often than not, somebody else will want to ask a similar question as well. So it basically saves up everybody's time if we do a engagement system, a online customer service this way. So as I want to stress again, if a system like this saves the time for the data producers, data processors, and data users, it has a real chance of being adopted. But if you make life easy for the users or for the processors, but you increase workload of the producers or vice versa, then this will get no adoption. To make a public policy, we need to have a correct database. Do I think our current government makes good use of data civil servants collect in making policy? This is a great question. I think it's case by case. If the data is strictly vertical, if the collection is, for example, by professionals working professional healthcare in the Ministry of Health and Welfare, and then if it's shared only vertically to the analysis people in the NHS, the National Healthcare Service, and for people to make like observations like epidemics and so on, actually, I think they're very professional, capable people. They have made very good predictions and analysis of public health problems and so on, if it's entirely vertical. But if they somehow require input of data across different ministries, across different databases, across, you know, even across the legislation and administration or the judiciary, then no, I think currently there are no very good way for unrelated ministries, unrelated units to suddenly start collaborating. And this is partly because much of those information systems are designed for the 长官, for the bosses to look at. And when people think about bosses, they think about vertical users. Not often do people procure a system for unrelated people in other ministries to look at. So this is one of the reasons why I try to spread the idea of what we call a decoupled architecture, in the sense that we collect the data, put it into a back-end database, but we don't restrict the kind of uses that it could use on the front-end. Some people want to build a website, some people want to build a chatbot, some people want to build data analytics, some people want to feed it into some other system, and it's all good uses. They're all first-class uses. So we try to procure the front-end and the back-end separately. And so the National Development Council will working with the join platform. We have consulted people for 60 days what they want to see in this kind of new procurement laws for API systems. And so maybe in a few months we will publish a new guideline for people to procure in a way that allows the data to be safely and protecting privacy shared between different ministries. That's one of the things that I care very much about and is becoming policy. I speak English very well. How do I practice it? I sing rap, if that counts. I do a lot of discussion with my friends. So for between 2008 and maybe 2013, that's 5 years, I work mostly with Silicon Valley companies, but I physically am in Taiwan. And this is because I don't like meetings at all. So I usually, go online and meet my colleagues through FaceTime or through Skype for an hour. And I said, it's midnight here, I really need to sleep. And so people tend to get very efficient if they know that I only have 1 hour to talk. And so they usually send me a lot of information beforehand and make the most of that hour. And then I go to sleep, and then they work day, and by the time I wake up, I usually have some products that's built by my staff. And then I can just carry out their work and do some analysis at my leisure. And they will not feel micromanaged by their manager, because then they get off work and then do whatever they like, and I spend the day here trying to go through their work and tell them what to do. So I think the idea here is that if we only have some time together and most of the time at our own tempo, people generally make much better use of each other's time in the time that we collaboratively share. On the other hand, if people meet every day and the most efficient way is just to hand me an envelope of paper and so on, then people never learn to use electronic communication methods to make their message easily understood, because, face-to-face is too convenient, but it means that it's not convenient for people who are not in the room. So what we are trying to do essentially is to keep a balance between face-to-face time and asynchronous time so that people can take care of their families and so on while still getting work done. So this is how I practice it, because I essentially work US jobs for many years before retirement. So there's a saying that says that I'm in charge of combating the so-called fake news. Is it true? What's it about? Well, I wouldn't use the word fake news. The word fake news is invented to offend the journalism people. It is a war between a certain president and certain presses, and it's not in Taiwan. And I don't think we should get into that particular war in the US. So I wouldn't use the word fake news. Rumors on the internet are not news. Many of them are not even purporting to be news. They're just rumors, or maybe it's just a cat picture or a people's picture with some captions or so on. One particular example is the after the Fukushima event, there is a picture from the US Nautical Agency, I think, of the Pacific Ocean. And then you see, from Japan, a lot of colors. So, for example, I don't have that here right now, but the basic idea is that you have the world here, and Japan's here, and then you have a lot of like lines here, and then a lot of distribution of lines here, and so on, and then slightly smaller or greener lines around here. Right, so, and then people will put a caption that says, it's the radioactive sea out of the nuclear incident from Japan. But it's not, the picture originally is about the height of waves of tsunami of after the Fukushima event. So the thing is that this is not news, this is just geographic data. And the caption itself, while it misleads people to think about it's about radiation, that's not even purport to be news. This is what we call a meme. It's a virus of the mind. If you look at it and you get impacted and you get affected, infected, you will want to share it with your friends saying, oh, radiation is very like horrific or something. And so it spreads among people and mutates just like any other virus. And then it reaches, this disinformation reaches a lot of people trying to change their affect, their feelings about particular things. But it's not news, and it's not fake news. It's just rumors that are viral. And we see a lot of these things here. So, no, I'm not in charge of combating the so-called fake news. There's a lot of rumors, there's a lot of such memes in the internet. It's not the government's job to, you know, combat it. Because combat is between people, right? One fighter fights another fighter. You can't fight a virus. A virus does not stand into a boxing ring and fight with you, right? It's not even in the same category. You don't negotiate with virus. You don't talk with virus. They're not human. These are just fragments, virus of the mind that are spreading, an environment that lets them spread. So just as with all kinds of virus, what we really need to do is about inoculation, about vaccination. Well, and inoculation and vaccination in mimetic, in memes, means that we talk over things, we listen to each other. Listening, and there's scientific proof for it, listening to each other's ideas about Uber, about labor law, about same-sex marriage, about whatever. If many people in different sides listen to each other's points, even if they don't agree for just 3 hours, 4 hours, they become immune to the virus of the mind, of that kind, of that topic. So basically it inoculates people because they have considered each other's positions. And no amount of virus or propaganda or memes will be able to affect people to share them. They will just look at it as, but it's not, it's a caricature. It's a straw man. It's not something that the other side of people, even if I don't agree, would use. So I think the government should just encourage deliberations, encourage listening, and maybe provide factual data whenever the government can provide factual data. But it's not about combating the virus, because they're not in the same category. They're not fighters. They're just non-conscious entities that spread. How about people who can't use the internet? How do they express their opinion in the platform? As I explained, for the socially disadvantaged people back in the Taipei City case, it is the social workers who bring the recorders to the socially disadvantaged people. It is the technical assistant from the Gulf Zero movement who brought the cameras to the socially disadvantaged people. It's not asking them to go to the internet services. It's to go to them, listen to them, and transcribe whatever they have said into online records so other people can make use of their input. The most important thing about internet in its role of communication is that, unlike radio and television, internet is not just for speaking, for broadcasting. If all we have is radio and television, All we can make is for millions of people to listen to one or two people to speak. But internet is bidirectional. All the high-speed internet that we put is bidirectional, which means that it's not just for watching movies. It's also for broadcasting your ideas and everybody's ideas. So if we deploy our technology well, it becomes a technology that enables not just for one or two people to speak to a million people, but for one or two people to listen to millions of people, and for millions of people to listen to one another. And so this is how we express our opinion. It's not to ask representatives, but to bring the internet to them. What else? Can I define open government? Yeah, I think I kind of did, right? Open government to me, at least, into the OECD countries and people in the OGP, in the Open Government Partnership, it means using digital tools to open up collaboration inside the government, to make open the policy development process and ask for participation. And if we do these approaches well, we achieve first a transparent data and transparent information during policy making. We get more people more interested in policy making and contribute to policy making. And then we get better accountability, meaning that when people ask what is being done, what's next, we can answer much more efficiently and truthfully, and then for people to take our answers and trust these answers. Maybe it's good news, maybe it's bad news, but it's not rumors. And finally, when doing these open government work, we also try to include more people than before, instead of just practicing and then gradually exclude people. I think to me this is the most important goal. The other three are just kind of part of the journey, but the end goal is much more inclusivity in the government functioning. So that's the definition I would use. It seems the idea of open government is based on the presumption that humanity can be trusted. However, in case of humanity cannot be trusted, will the arbitrary decision trump other discussion? This is a very good question. One of the philosophers that I like very much, Lao Tzu, said that to give no trust is to get no trust. Right? 心不足焉，有不信焉. The idea is that trust is a bidirectional relationship. If you start saying that humanity cannot be trusted, well, you don't trust strangers then. If you don't trust strangers, strangers have no reason to trust you. And it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. Of course, there is no trust because, well, you start with this position. And it's self-fulfilling. I would not say that you're wrong. You're right. But that's because you start with your destination. On the other hand, if we say that we trust even bad people, if we trust even people with malicious intent, if we trust people who don't deserve to be trusted, then maybe, just maybe, some of them will start to see that it pays to actually, contribute. Because destructive actions just waste their time without wasting our time because we have, good electronic systems. And before Wikipedia, not many people other than we programmers will think that this is a better model. But after Wikipedia, people start to think, okay, maybe in some cases allow open contribution while having very good system in hand to, revert destructive behavior actually results in something that's creative. So I think this is not about blindly trusting or blindly distrusting. This is about starting with the most degree of trust that you can muster without harming yourself, without degrading your life's quality, and see what happens. Because after all, well, what was to lose? The alternative is a cold, uncaring world. I think our government is willing to listen to the public when making policies. I really do believe when President said that our government is the most willing to listen. But the most willing is not the most capable. It's two very different things. Right, so maybe this administration is more capable at listening than the previous administrations, but it's not saying much. We're still very early when it comes to trusting people, when it comes to actual listen to many sides at once instead of just one at a time, which was the previous model. So I would not overpromise and say we're already good at it, but at least we're willing to experiment and whether it's good or not, like with the Uber case, it's not all good at the end, but at least we documented very well and for the world actually to see. And so many other countries are actually taking our experience with Uber and Airbnb and doing a better job than we do, but starting with the process that we discovered, and it's an international collaboration. 3 more minutes. How do I think of my work so far? I think it is meaningful. I don't think it's tiring. And I say this because other than going to Taizhou and giving a speech, usually when I work in Taipei, I go to work around 8:45 or something, and I always leave work before 6 p.m. So because one of the public service culture is that if I don't leave the office, none of the staff leaves the office for some reason, I don't really know. It wasn't like that in Silicon Valley. So in any case, I discovered that if I don't go to home like at 5 p.m. on time, none of my staff will do so. So I always, even if I have something that I'm doing, but I would just put it down and then go back. And because I've set up the workspace in such a way that I can work from anywhere really, I usually just still work on the car back home and then back home and then start working again. But the thing here is that this is back to the tempo that I'm most used to, which is to determine the workflow in the speed that I want to. So it never gets tiring, because if I get tired, well, I just go to sleep. It's not like that I have to work overtime. And because my staff also don't work overtime, well, except like today, where it's the way it came with me and had to work overtime. We don't usually work overtime, so usually we have a really good morale and not tiring at all. It's possible ruling party open critical information is that critical information is confidential document in purpose and benefit from that. Yes, of course. But the point here is the ruling party is at the moment independent. Because if you look at the cabinet and our ministers, you'll discover that 40% of the cabinet members are actually independents, and 30% DPP and 30% KMT. Or so. So politics-wise, we have a very interesting cabinet at the moment. The largest faction is the independent faction, and not DPP or the KMT, and including the premier and me. And I think that creates a much more collaborative atmosphere, especially in our cabinet meetings. We really don't see that it is a ruling party that tries to keep the other party out of the public information. Instead, we see that the evidence or the data or information we share are actually useful to the world in general. Now, I can't say the same, of course, with the other branches of the national government. I say this just for the administration branch, but well, it's the branch that I work in. People in Taiwan tend to take all instead of sharing with others. Do they think open government can improve to change the situation? Yeah, of course. So this is basically scarcity versus abundance. Scarcity means zero sum. If I take something, well, the pie is smaller and you get less, right? It's a zero sum game. But for a lot of economy, and Taiwan has transitioned to a knowledge economy. In knowledge economy, if you take something, you improve it, actually the pie gets larger. The more you take, actually the pie gets larger. In knowledge economy, the only scarcity is artificial scarcity. That is to say, if you restrict the copies. And I have practiced so far a complete renouncement of copyright. So every single work that I do, all the programs that I wrote, all the articles I wrote, all the speech that I gave is in the public domain. Meaning that if you take it and you said you wrote it, I would not sue you. I don't really care. I care about the act of creation. I care about people using the work or benefiting from the work. But I don't care about copyright, about ownership, because for me there is no ownership when it comes to the knowledge economy. And so, yes, I do think working in the collaborative way like that changes people so that they can see in many situations it is possible for all the parties to win or at least not lose. Of course, it's not applicable if you have a very short time frame and you have to decide in a day what to do, then sometimes there will be casualties and problems like that, which is why we're trying to start a policy discussion well before the deadline. Two more questions. What would the future public servant union to be applied to the current laws? Yeah, that's a very fair question. And it is actually part of my slides. We kind of just ignore the slides. So basically the idea is that every other country has some sort of union rights, but Taiwan doesn't have any of it. But other than France, people don't usually allow public servant go on strike. So it's not exactly the same as the union. And so what we have done is to start with these rights and then improve the existing associations while also not disallowing future revision of labor law to apply to the public servants. And so this is one of the idea developments that our participation officers drew. It's like, okay, we have a perfect circle representing the full rights of unions, but our current association rights are kind of very restrictive. We can only negotiate our workspace environments and so on. So we need to make compromises. And within the existing framework to extend the thing that could be collectively negotiated, whereas also allowing the legislative branch to propose the labor law to apply to public servants. So administration will not actively block the legislation from introducing labor law to public service if they want to. But we, at least, will work with the Kao Shi Yuan, the Yuan of the Examination, on improving the association law so people can also enjoy more rights. So these are the consensus items that we managed to agree on. So the final question. It seems not many people know join.gov.tw. How do we collect the ideas? Well, we spread to stakeholders. The idea of all these platforms is not to ask 23 million people to come and have a meaningful discussion. If we had to do that, it would be like holding a referendum for every policy, and it's not practical using current technology. Of course, you can try to randomly draw 100 people or 1,000 people and have some discussion, but even that is not a habit here, because we don't have a jury system, or we don't have this kind of habit. But maybe we'll introduce a jury system as part of the reformation, right? So in any case, before we have this kind of jury duty idea, all we can do on this kind of online platform is to ask stakeholders, ask people who will be affected by the policy to come and have a discussion. This is much easier. Because if you let them know beforehand, they will want to participate because they get affected. But for people who are not affected in any particular case, we're not asking people to just come and share with us those ideas, because at the moment, Taiwan doesn't have a very active jury culture. So that's all my responses for tonight, and thanks for spending the time with me, and thank you very much.